at 8 p.m. Eastern on ESPN2 in the app. The Sun take on the Mystics at Mohegan Sun Arena in my great state of Connecticut. For football history buffs, Sunday was the 18th meeting between Mike Tomlin and John Harbaugh in which the game was decided by one possession, the most by any coach versus coach duo in the Super Bowl era. The edge went to the Ravens, pulling off a 26-23 win in overtime. Pittsburgh wasn't able to overcome their injuries offensively, down to their third-string quarterback after Mason Rudolph left the game with a very scary concussion. Ryan Clark back here with us. Max, are you buying or selling the Ravens as contenders?
I'm selling them as contenders. I don't think Lamar Jackson is ready yet to call them Super Bowl contenders. I think eventually, you know, I bring it up all the time, Stephen A. Warren Sharp, Sharp Analytics, put me on to the fact that Lamar Jackson, in fact, is the most accurate passer at age 21 he was in the history of the NFL, which is amazing. Because when you watch him, you don't think of him as a very accurate passer, particularly down the field. But you have to consider what age 21 means. It's a baby. Traditionally, especially, now less so, but it's still a baby. So your age 22 season, do I believe a quarterback who needs work in that regard, not in his age group, but just in a kind of absolute sense, is he ready to take an offense to a Super Bowl? No, I don't think he is. I just don't think he's ready. And once teams realize that, it's a one-dimensional attack that's much easier to stop. And then when you combine that with their defensive problems, just because the Ravens brand is defense, doesn't mean they automatically play the defense. I have to sell them as contenders.
I'm not going to say that. And I think that you have to take into account the level of competition. Again, if you're looking at it in a vacuum and just looking at them and saying, excuse me, are they Super Bowl contenders? You've got Hollywood Brown as one of your receivers. Mark Andrews is another. Obviously, you look at Mark Ingram as a quarterback. Yeah, averaging over 5 yards a carry or about 5 yards a carry in the season, but he's not considered elite. Lamar Jackson is running, you know, out of the backfield as your quarterback, for crying out loud, and that really buffers their running attack, which makes their running attack one of the best in the NFL. I think they're ranked number one right now. As an offense overall, number three in yards, number one with their rushing attack. I think that has everything to do with Lamar Jackson. So now we get to the playoffs, and we say to ourselves, okay, what are the kind of things that works for you in a playoff setting? Regardless of what we saw a couple of weeks ago when they went against Cleveland, the Baltimore Ravens defense is usually a defense to be respected, particularly as a season wanes. You combine that with the fact that you have a quarterback who's not a stationary target like a Joe Flacco was, and a guy that has the potential to move the chains because of what he can do with his feet, not necessarily as an elite thrower of the football. And then you couple that with what we're seeing from the rest of the National Football League. My mentality is that I look at it and I say, excuse me, could they beat the Patriots? Potentially. Could they give Kansas City a run for their money? Yes. Do we look at Indianapolis? Do we look at Houston? For example, I would consider Houston a contender because of Deshaun Watson. I'm looking at those things, and I'm looking again. It's almost by default. It's the level of competition that exists within the conference,
Ryan,
that's making me say that.
Ryan, I'm sorry. Let me just say one thing real quick.
Sure.
Stephen A., I know you. Oh, and sitting here with a guy who you don't believe in as a thrower of the football. Because that's what you emphasize.
That's true.
As the quarterback who could win a Super Bowl at age 22.
No. I just specifically said I'm considering the level of competition within the conference. Okay, that's what I highlighted, and that's what I kept emphasizing. And I said, by default, I'm still critical of someone's inability to throw the football, even though we've all recognized the improvement from year one to two that Lamar Jackson has had. When I hold against Cam Newton, his, you know, in terms of the questionable throwing ability, I'm looking at the fact within your own division, there are two throwers of the football better. I'm looking at the NFC conference as being considerably more stout. And that's what I'm pointing to. The road to prosperity for Cam Newton is far more arduous than that of Lamar Jackson.
Absolutely. Now, and I'm going to be honest, I think Cam Newton was a better thrower of the football than we've seen Lamar be consistently. Especially early on in his career. But I don't believe that this team is a Super Bowl contender. And it's so difficult to get history out of our minds and thinking that, you know what, the Baltimore Ravens play defense. not this Baltimore Ravens team, though. Marlon Humphrey has been good. They haven't had the type of pressure that we're used to seeing. And what happened with Lamar Jackson happens so often with quarterbacks who are considered, quote unquote, running quarterbacks. Now he's taking some of that athleticism away, trying to show people that he can sit in the pocket and make throws. There were opportunities yesterday where if he uses his legs, which to me is still where he's going to make his money, at least early on in his career, this team is in a better position. And you look at what he was doing early. He was forcing the ball into tough spots, into coverage. He throws a deep out route into cover three. We're seeing right here where it's picked off by Hilton. The decision making has become a little suspect to me. Trying to fit some throws in places where he doesn't necessarily have to. They're not using him and getting him outside of the pocket. Greg Roman is not being as creative as you think he should be because we watched early success. But let's remember who that early success was against. It was the Miami Dolphins. It was the Arizona Cardinals. And we saw some things from him that were encouraging. But in the last two games, there's been five turnovers against Kansas City for the first three quarters. They couldn't get anything going in the passing game. So they're going to have to do some more things with Lamar's legs. Be a little bit more creative, getting him outside of the pocket, giving him options of run pass and not saying, you know what, Lamar, right now, today, we need you to be the pocket passer that we have to have you be in the future. It's about using what he does best. And from a defensive standpoint, it's different when Earl Thomas comes over from the Seattle Seahawks and all he's done there is sit in the middle of the field and it's been kind of that cover three single high defenses. We've seen Nick Chubb and we've seen some different angles from him not be the same or the things that we're used to seeing from an Earl Thomas. You lose Tony Jefferson yesterday, who was a very good strong safety who had done a lot for that team, played multiple positions. And so this team has a lot to learn. This team has a long way to grow if we're expecting them to compete with Kansas City. You're expecting them to compete with the New England Patriots or even the Houston Texans and Indianapolis Colts that I think are ahead of them right now from a quarterback standpoint and from a team standpoint. And so for me, this Baltimore Ravens team is not even in the conversation. It started off this season against lesser competition that we thought this team could compete to win the AFC North, which they still can because it's not as strong, Stephen A. But even looking at the AFC as a whole, this team doesn't win, this team doesn't cut it, and it's another year away from even competing to be an AFC champion.
Yeah, got that Patriots defense on them. Belichick scheme up something in the playoffs. It's not going to be
as far as I just want to say this, Mason Rudolph, he did suffer a concussion, but I'm glad to hear that he is okay because that was a scary hit. Yesterday, watching Red Zone, I felt like every second I was seeing these major hits where guys are lying motionless.
Can we mention that for a quick second here about that hit? I understand the penalized play on the part of
Earl Thomas.
Okay, let me be very, very clear. I didn't have that much of a problem with the hit. Help me out here, Ryan, because I thought
I did.
I'm just saying it wasn't intentionally helmet to helmet or crown or whatever the case may be. You could see that he tried to get his shoulder into the mix there. I don't think that that's something that Earl Thomas should be fined or suspended for
that. Before you comment, Ryan, because you'll be the arbiter here, the arbitrator. I'll say this: I think he should be ejected for a shot like that.
No,
I'll tell you why. You could say he tried to get the shoulder in. What I saw was this: a guy launching with his helmet.
No.
Yes, he raised his shoulder. True, but he launched. And he hit a guy helmet to helmet. And here's how I feel about this rule. There are times where I say, what do you want a guy to do? There's no way he could have avoided that. And I'm on that player's side. But we have seen with all the stuff with CT, et cetera, et cetera. Seen an emphasis starting last year on exactly this kind of play.
No.
They should enforce it uniformly.
Here's the side of his face, side of his helmet. That's what you saw.
If you look at Earl Thomas, Earl Thomas' head, his head is up. It does hit Mason Rudolph slightly under the chin, but he didn't go directly into his helmet. He didn't launch from the standpoint to where he got parallel to the ground. And what Max, right now, what you're judging this playoff is the result.
Yep.
And a lot of times I definitely had an issue with referees because they would watch a play and it would be physical and it would be fast. And they would look at the quarterback or look at the wide receiver that was being hit and you would judge the play off of the result. You have to judge it by the intention of the
hit. Okay, let me ask this.
You have to judge it by the way that the defender and the tackler approaches the tackle. And this wasn't malicious. This wasn't intentional.
But there's
it
a
wasn't
way,
late.
But- But there's a way that in every sport, you could talk about baseball, a pitcher. Oh, I was going after the inside part of the plate. But it's also like, okay, but if you happen to be there, you're going to get nailed, right? Mm-hmm. Or a boxer swinging his head. He's like, well, it wasn't an intentional headbutt. But if your face happens to be there, here comes my head. So it's certainly not an effort, really, in my view, to make sure something like that doesn't happen.
Come on, Matt.
I'm usually on the side of the defensive player, but not this time.
But you're so wrong. And here's why you're so wrong. Because of what you said, Max. You said he launched at him. He did no such thing. He did not launch. If you look at the play, his shoulder was up. He raised his shoulder. The side of his helmet, his head hit Mason Rudolph. He didn't launch. It wasn't the crown. The crown of his helmet was nowhere in the vicinity. There is no way on earth that you can look at that play and use your words and say that Earl Thomas launched at him. He did no such thing.
With his helmet first, and then he kind of got his shoulder up. Look, I agree.
Shoulders up in the form.
I think he got his shoulder up as an afterthought, but my point is this.
As an afterthought?
Yes. My point is this. Hold on. I agree it's more ambiguous than some shots where you go, that's it. That guy's ejected. I agree there's ambiguity. My point is, in the event of ambiguity, you enforce the rule, and that will do the best job.
But that's the point, if you're enforcing the rule, he did nothing against the rule in that case. It wasn't a spear. He didn't lower the crown of his helmet. He didn't leave his feet to launch. And you're
He did leave his feet.
You're talking about he did not.
I'll look at I will look at it again. It looked to me like he was off his feet.
Max, when in tackling a player right there with the way that Mason Rudolph is coming, the only way that he launches or gets lower is if he leaves his feet to cut Mason Rudolph low or hit him inside the numbers. I agree there was a way that he could have gotten his head from hitting Mason Rudolph under the chin. But when you're looking at a spear, when you're looking at something that is done intentionally, or even the targeting rule that is now being enforced in college football, there are none of those things that Earl Thomas did. And now you're watching this play to see the result, to see what happens to Mason Rudolph, to realize that he's knocked out.
Ryan,
you see the aftermath of him being carted off. And all of these things are going into
Ryan,
the play
of how
you see it.
I'm not denying that has a part in it. I'm not denying that if it,
but
if
that's
it
not,
didn't.
You can't, you can't officiate
how he launched.
No, I understand. Your point is well taken, that I am allowing the result to influence the way I'm thinking about the play. Nevertheless, I do think if a guy is knocked out and it's ambiguous in terms of the intention of the defender, that's an ejection in my view.
Wow.
Yep.
All right.
Wow.
So you don't even know his intent, and clearly from an act from an but actionable I, perspective, there's no evenance to show that you're valid
right,
in terms of him launching. But go ahead and eject him.
I did see leading with the head. I did see that. I saw also
anatomically,
a shoulder come up.
Anatomically, if you bend at the waist at any point, your head will be in front of your shoulders. That's just the way God made us.
Gentlemen, we're out of time. Steelers 1-4 face the Chargers next week. Still to come on First Take. With the Eagles now tied for first place in the NFC East, has Carson Wentz returned to MVP form? Plus, did Dak Prescott make a huge mistake by not signing a contract extension earlier this season? You do not want to miss Stephen A's take on the Cowboys quarterback coming up.